Yes, the relay on YouTube. Check it out. Lots of stories about me on there. All the boxing facts and info that you want in a very entertaining, educational manner. The relay. Check it out on YouTube.
Welcome to the motherfucking relay, where we're covering today's top boxing
news.
Okay, we'll start with this. Per a tweet from Michael Benson, Bob Arum has revealed they have now reserved December 19th at the new Allegiant Stadium in Vegas to potentially host Tyson Fury versus Deontay Wilder 3.
No lawsuit?
No investigation? What about all this insurmountable evidence of foul play on the part of Tyson Fury? That you can see Tyson Fury's fist in the wrist part of the glove while simultaneously being able to see his fist on the front part of the glove, but also...
What?
He had some kind of a metal object tucked inside of the glove.
Wait a minute.
I mean, which one is it? A couple of months ago, you're telling me that Tyson Fury achieved some kind of a competitive edge by keeping his fist in the wrist portion of the glove. Now the story is that you can see his fist, the outline of it, in the front of the glove, and the horsehair padding was removed.
Wait, was he wearing a glove or not?
I'm not really sure. The narrative, the conspiracy, as it were, it keeps changing. But for all these changes that this narrative, this conspiracy, keeps experiencing, they don't seem to be having any effect at all in the real world and what's going on in the real world. As those who opt for this conspiracy theory, those individuals don't live in the real world themselves.
Nope.
They live in the digital world.
The internet.
A world where you can make these kinds of accusations with no burden of proof.
You can believe it.
You can believe it all the lid long day. In the digital world, you can believe whatever the fuck you like.
Yeah, knock yourself out.
But it's what happens in the real world that matters. It's what happens in the real world that counts. And in the real world, this little doctored up conspiracy theory,
it's gone nowhere.
It's not getting off the ground. It's not having any tangible effect whatsoever in the real world.
The fight is still a goal.
One is left to wonder, what if all these videos, this endless stream,
nonsense,
talking heads talking up this conspiracy theory, what has it actually achieved?
Nothing.
These two fucking guys, they're still fighting. I mean, that's what all these reports indicate from credible news sources, those in the know, the movers, shakers, decision makers. I mean, what do you think? That the people over there at Top Rank and the PBC, the people over there at ESPN and Fox, are going as far as reserving Allegiant Stadium as the potential site for the third fight because it's not happening?
Oh.
Do you think that they'd be reserving Allegiant Stadium if they were in the midst of a potential lawsuit? You think they'd be reserving this stadium if Wilder's people were gearing up to file suit against Tyson Fury for foul play in the second fight? Is that what you think would be going on?
If these rumors were true.
If this conspiracy theory held any water.
Any truth.
At all. Do you think they'd be reserving Allegiant Stadium as the potential site for the third fight?
Let me make it easier for you.
Let me clue you in. The answer, put simply, is no. If there were any truth to these allegations being levied against Tyson Fury, allegations that insinuate foul play, they wouldn't be reserving Allegiant Stadium as the potential site for the third fight. Quite honestly, the third fight would be in jeopardy as a legal battle.
In the courtroom.
As opposed to a battle in the squared circle. Would be what's brewing. That's not what's going on, is it? No. All systems are a go for a third fight. No lawsuit.
No investigation.
No word from Deontay Wilder, the man himself, asking for one.
Nothing.
Abso-fucking-lutely nothing. Nothing outside of YouTubers propagating a conspiracy theory for profit. Profiteering off the ignorance of those too stupid to see through this con job.
Because that's what it always was.
To be completely honest, I don't find it at all celebratory news that the third fight is a go. I'm not very much intrigued by what happens if these guys step into the squared circle for a third time, but I am intrigued by what will be the buildup of the fight, what leads up to it, those press conferences, when Deontay Wilder is going to have to be faced with the guy that stopped him, exposed him, and took his belt. I am intrigued by that and how Deontay Wilder is going to handle himself in that situation, having said so much. Tyson Fury is a feather-fisted guy who can't punch?
Wilder said it the last set of press conferences.
If there's anything intriguing about this tight fight, at least for me, it would be that. It would be the build-up, or what is to be the build-up. The press conferences leading up to the tight fight. Assuming that there even are any, because, you know, we're in the midst of a global pandemic, and what could be a second wave of cases coming in as a result of COVID-19. You'd have to be naive to think to yourself that anything is promised at this point, that we will see press conferences for the tight fight, similar to the ones that we saw for the second and the first fight. But I hope that we do, because for me, personally, it's those press conferences that are intriguing more so than anything else. We've already seen what these two guys are capable of two times already in a squared circle against each other. As far as I'm concerned, Tyson Fury won both those fights. He just put a stamp on it the last time. So I've already seen what I needed to see, and it's the press conferences ahead of the tight fight that I'm looking forward to the most, more so than the actual fight itself. As there are still big questions about the mental state of Deontay Wilder. You don't have to look far and wide to find someone who thinks that Wilder is mentally broken, and that a puncher like Wilder, punchers like Wilder, when they take a loss, it's a little different than when a more methodical fighter, technical kind of guy, cerebral kind of guy, takes a loss. As that cerebral guy is accustomed to having to make adjustments, whereas a puncher is a puncher through and through. And when that punch doesn't get them through, where do they go from there? The mental state of Deontay Wilder has been obscure, guarded, as of late in the aftermath of the second fight. But if there are press conferences ahead of the third, we'll get to take a good long look at this guy and you know, just take it all in. How's he holding up? Is he ready to do the dance for a third time? What these reports indicate is that one way or another, we're going to find out, because all systems are a go for the rubber match. In other news, Eddie Reynoso was quoted as saying that King Ryan Garcia is going to knock out Luke Campbell, to which Ryan Garcia replied, "It's time to shock the world, coach. Let's go." And I like this energy. I like this enthusiasm. I very much like what I'm seeing from Ryan Garcia, because boxing is a spectator sport, and we are spectators in said spectator sport. So what we see,
it's shown to us.
That energy, that enthusiasm, we're along for the ride. This kind of talk from a young fighter with so much to prove effectively galvanizes the boxing community at large. They share in that fighter's energy, that fighter's enthusiasm, in what is a step up in competition for him. And that's exciting.
That's entertainment.
Tell you what, it's a hell of a lot more exciting than Yordanis Ugas fighting Abel Ramos for a fucking baby belt. You know, when it comes to citing fighters, I think somewhere along the way, they lost their drive and they started treating the sport as if it's your run-of-the-mill 9-to-5 job. You're just going through the motions, you know?
Pretty much.
For this reason, we often see these fights that fail to excite. These fights that can only be characterized as the most reward for the least risk.
Which are understandable.
I mean, I get it. I get the hierarchy of thought. It's just that those kinds of situations really aren't the least bit exciting.
They're not.
And excitement is what you have to sell in the sport of boxing. That air of intrigue, not really knowing, not being sure what's going to happen when two guys climb through those ropes and decide to swap punches with each other. That's the sizzle. That's the intrigue, and that helps to sell the fight. That helps to make superstars, legends. That essence, that competitive spirit has been missing as of late, at least for some. Some who willfully choose the path of least resistance. And we talked about Yordanis Ugas' comments in my previous video, where he said, you know, you basically can't believe fighters when they say that they want to be great. They don't want to be great. They just want to get paid. And I don't think that's true for every fighter. I don't think that's true across the board. I think that's true for Yordanis Ugas.
For him.
And his stablemates. Perhaps to those guys, that is the reality underneath it all of their careers. But for some others out there, they know that being great and getting paid, those two things aren't mutually exclusive. In fact, they're synonymous with each other. Because the greater you are, the more you'll get paid. But it takes a certain element to get to that point, to get there. It takes drive. It takes passion. It takes wanting to take risks and wanting to be the best. When you're doing what you love, there is a genuine desire that comes from the individual and no one else to aspire to be great. And boxing ain't your run-of-the-mill 9-to-5. You have to want to be there. It's not the kind of profession to where you can afford to just go through the motions and hope to get anywhere. In boxing, you have to want to be there. You have to want to be great. Just so happens that there are certain fighters out there that treat it like it's just a job, like any other job.
Clock in, clock out.
I'll tell you, they're not going to get very far doing that. Nothing ventured, nothing gained. And we see time and time again with certain fighters of a certain stable that they're constantly looking for the cheat code and the shortcuts. You're not aspiring to be great by doing this.
But it's your life.
And it's your career. You can run it however the hell you like. What you can't expect is for people to be fooled by it. You can't expect them to be along for the ride and not notice what's actually going on. When it comes to Ryan Garcia, this energy that he's exhibiting is the energy of someone who is aspiring to be great. He doesn't just want to win. He wants to win in sensational fashion. And that's the right mindset. He's got the right idea. This kid, he's on the ball. I have to admit that Ryan Garcia seemed a bit of a prima donna to me based on recent reports. All these demands from what pretty much is a prospect.
It's too soon.
It's too soon for all of that. But if he can stay this guy and maintain this energy, this is the essence of a fighter.
And what could make him a superstar.
And finally, a rather interesting bit of news involving Golden Boy, Mayweather Promotions, and Top Rank. Apparently, all three of these parties applied for forgivable loans amidst the pandemic. The exact amounts requested weren't available from data released Monday by the federal government, but three companies each requested $350,000 and $1 million to help offset the economic impact of the coronavirus crisis. The data doesn't indicate either whether Golden Boy Promotions, Mayweather Promotions, or Top Rank Inc. accepted any of the money for which those companies applied. Through the PPP, Congress created $659 billion in low-interest loans that won't have to be paid back if the assisted companies apply the money to payroll, rent, and other business expenses. According to the Associated Press, approximately $130 billion of PPP money remained unclaimed as the June 30 deadline, which prompted Congress to extend the program's deadline until August 8th. The truth is that this news comes as no surprise to me because most anyone and everyone in the sport of boxing right now is feeling the pinch. It comes as no surprise to me that a smaller outfit like a TMT, Mayweather Promotions, is feeling the same kind of pinch that a bigger outfit like a Top Rank might be feeling. Golden Boy?
It's no surprise.
You know, I remember when news broke a couple of weeks ago that the people over there at the Zone were feeling the pinch, that they were might be experiencing some financial issues amidst this global pandemic. There were those out there who wanted to make things seem one way, as if it was only the people over there at the Zone that were suffering, when here we see that the suffering is distributed evenly across the board. All these different companies didn't apply for loans because of how fucking well they're doing and how business is on the up and up. Everybody in the sport is suffering to some degree. The sport's ability to generate the kind of revenue that it normally generates is severely hindered by the absence of a live gate. The kind of big fights that generate big money, you can't stage them quite the same way as you could before. And who knows when boxing will fully recover from this pandemic, when we're hearing reports of what could be a second wave. You gotta understand, each one of these companies, each one of these promotional outfits, they have their money makers. But their money makers, they're not out there right now
making that money. It's
largely in part because in the absence of a live gate, in the absence of a live audience, it greatly affects how much money you can make, even when you are normally a money maker.
It's just reality.
But you know, I don't see as many people in a rush to report on this story as they were a few weeks ago.
About the Zone.
They were talking about the Zone and what could be the Zone's financial woes, their financial struggles. You will notice that Mayweather Promotions, which falls under the PBC umbrella, applied for a loan, the same as Top Rank, the same as Golden Boy. They're not immune. And why would they be?
They're feeling it too.
In fact, they might be feeling it a little worse than either Top Rank or Golden Boy, because Mayweather Promotion's stable of fighters isn't as deep as either Top Rank's or Golden Boy's stable of fighters. That's right. Mayweather Promotions has Gervonta Davis, Badu Jack, and who else?
Huh?
These two fighters, these are the kind of fighters that normally command roughly $1 million a fight. $1 million prices. The kind of prices that are hard to give right now, all things considered, to a fighter. You look over at Top Rank, they might have their big guns, their big hitters, their big money makers holstered at the moment, but their stable is deep enough that their lesser known fighters, their lesser known guys, can still get out there and they can still stage cards for those guys. Mayweather Promotions don't have that option.
Their stable ain't deep enough.
So they're feeling it right now. They are. They don't have the ability to put on very many, if any, cards at the moment. Whereas Top Rank, they've already hit the ground, and they've hit the ground running. Matchroom USA will be soon to follow. In August, Matchroom USA, who you will notice, wasn't mentioned in this article. They didn't apply for a loan.
I guess they didn't need a loan.
Now, how many of those pro PBC channels are going to talk about that? Where the people over there at Matchroom are gearing up to stage cards, transatlantic cards, in both the UK and the USA, what the people over there at Mayweather Promotions are doing, which falls under the PBC umbrella, they're doing, is applying for forgivable loans.
How many videos do you think those guys are going to make about that?
Hey, I'm just giving it to you straight. There were a lot of people that wanted you to believe that it's the Matchroom people, all the DAZN people, they're the only ones suffering in the midst of this crisis. The fact of the matter is, Matchroom's not listed as applying for a forgivable loan, but Mayweather Promotions is, and Mayweather Promotions falls under the PBC umbrella.
You having financial trouble?
You're talking about loans that range between 6 and 7 figures.
Right.
Roughly $1 million, right? One would think that that would be a drop in the bucket for what is Floyd Mayweather's own promotional company, the company by his own name. What's $1 million to that guy?
Well, they had to apply for a loan.
Look, all I'm trying to tell you is that everybody's feeling the pinch right now. To some degree, everybody is. But there are those out there who choose to report the news in a rather uneven fashion, uneven method. And I don't think that they're going to spend anywhere near as much time on Mayweather Promotions applying for a forgivable loan as they did when it came to DAZN. But comparatively, you tell me, who's got their plan of action ironed out already? Who's got the month of August mapped out? People over there at DAZN, Matchroom, USA, and the UK, or the people over there at Mayweather Promotions?
You tell me.
Who's really suffering the most here?
You tell me.
The guys that are actually staging cards, or the guys that can't? The guys who have the means and the methods to continue to work through this pandemic, or the guys who have no choice but to be forced into inactivity? The guys that don't have that luxury? You tell me.